Hello, Adil. How you doing?
I'm good. It's been a very long time since we've spoken, my friend. How have you been?
I'm really good. I'm not bad. Things are okay. And hey, remind me. We met at a conference or something, but I don't remember where it was or when it was. Do you
Mark
remember?
Anastasi, 2009, September. I want to say September 21st.
That
Or September
sounds.
20th.
Wow, you've got a sharp memory.
Oh, it was because it was a couple of days before my birthday.
Ah, I see. So, Mark Anastasi, did you say 2009?
Yeah.
And now let me see if I remember. That must have been, was it one of his ebook seminars or something, or was it one of his big events?
It was one of his bigger events because, like, I can tell you who was there because I was actually crewing that event.
Ah.
So we had Alex Goad, Saj P, Stephen Esser, Brett McFall, and Reed Florine. Those are the five people I remember.
It's weird because I haven't been on the scene. Like, I've been completely out of the loop. I've been doing
Oh
handstands for 10 years, right?
yeah. I've been watching.
And so I don't really know what's going on in the internet marketing, like the seminar world. I got no idea. So, are you still in that world?
No. I went direct response copy and basically built up a portfolio. Right. I have written for a couple of those guys since and still do every so often, but it's not my main focus.
Okay, so tell us more. So, what do you do exactly?
Oh, so what I do is I basically created this template known as the story selling template, or basically the story selling blueprint, initially what it was called, and then turned to a bunch of other stuff. Basically, it's combining everything I know about storytelling and all the stuff I've studied and done and created because I was a stand-up comedian as well.
What?
Yeah.
Don't tell us. That's tell us about that.
We will get to that in just a moment.
Okay.
But what essentially happened was I've been a lifelong storyteller. Like, it's just been so p a part of me. So I learned how to write direct response around the time we actually met, believe it or not. It was like 2 years, like a year into my actual professional journey at that point. And that seminar was so pivotal for me because Alex actually was the one that told me, what are you good at? And I told him, I had 10 people read a blog post and seven of them gave me money. He was like, oh, so you're a copywriter. I was like, I have no idea what one of those is. And it kind of just progressed from there. So over that time, I built up my copywriting ability, started writing million-dollar launches for basically every market I could get my hands on because I believed you shouldn't niche down to one thing. Like, hey, I just do launch copy for self-development. I'm like, that's too limited and bored the hell out of me. So I decided not to go that path. And then once I combined everything I knew about story into how I wrote ads in a very unconscious manner, and then about 3 years ago, I started bringing it to more conscious frontal usage on how you can basically find your story, create a personal brand around you, and actually sell from that idea and brand using direct response principles, but not in a rigidity that basically made it not fun because we've all read long form sales letters that are not fun. And this is just a way to actually combine the not so fun aspects with a lot more fun, interesting aspects to keep people going. So that's basically what I did. And the stand-up comedy, surprisingly, was 2, 3 days after we met, was
Really?
the first time I was on stage. Not even by choice. My friend had taken me out for my birthday. And he basically got me on. Like, we were at a. He was drinking, I wasn't, because I don't drink. And he basically was on stage, and the comic didn't show up for the open mic night. One of the comics didn't show up. So they had this open mic for 10 minutes and said, does anyone in the crowd want to come up and just, do a bit? And I thought only an idiot would go up there because at the time I was quite extroverted but quite shy as well. My social anxiety was quite high. My best friend basically, like, put his hand up, spot, they were like, you, yes. He was like, no, this guy next to me right here. I look, I'm like, oh, you asshole. Just immediately throws me on stage. I'm like a deer in headlights, and 10 seconds has never felt longer in my life. Especially when everything's silent, you're like, oh, what the hell do I talk about? And I'm umming and ahhing, trying to fill space. And my friend just yells from the back of the room, like, just talk about your dad. And I just went off on this huge tirade about what my dad thought of me. And, add the crowd in stitches. So I just basically started performing more frequently from that point. And then about 3 years, 4 years after that, I kind of took a break away from it. And now I'm kind of coming back again.
So, did you have a background in performing or drama or theatre or something?
No, God, no. I was, my projected profession of all things was to be a martial artist.
Right.
That's where I wanted to go when I was younger, but I've always written stories. So the way that I can put it is I have a very strong creativity background, but it was never nurtured. So I did a lot of things that were creative, but they were never like nurtured and promoted towards me. They were never told like, oh, hey, you're really good at telling stories. You should go do this. Hey, you're really good at this way of speaking. Go do this. You should, you know, you really enjoy being dramatic and showing like different angles and embodying characters. You should go do this. The only encouragement I got on anything to develop on was my voice acting. That was like the only thing I got an access to at a young age for my background. But the stand-up thing just threw me for a loop, and I was just grateful that I had a lot of stories to tell.
So, I mean, when did you first start writing or writing stories? How did that begin?
So my story's kind of strange, and I'll explain in a moment why. So I've always loved creativity. So when I was really young, I wanted to be a cartoonist. That was actually the first career I wanted to have because I loved cartoons. I thought, wow, the people who make these must be amazing. So I want to be one of them. I got good at art. And then my dad wasn't able to walk for about 2 years from the time I was 5 to the time I was 7. And obviously I'd want to watch cartoons so I can get ideas to draw things. My sister wanted to watch Nickelodeon because she was older than me. So we used to argue about who gets to watch what, and the idea that I came up with was I'll sit with Dad and watch whatever the hell he wanted to watch, and then I could watch cartoons, get ideas, and draw them later.
Right.
And this went on for about 2 years. The thing my dad loved to do more than anything was to watch QVC and the Home Shopping Channel. Just loved it. So for 2 hours a day, this was being fed into my very influential young mind. And then I went back to school and always write really weird stories during story time. I remember this one time I decided, because my stories were based on like video games or anything or like computer games, anything I could really see and kind of like, ooh, that's a good idea. I'll write about this. And it was always more towards like geared towards what boys are generally geared towards, stuff like Mortal Kombat, Call of Duty. Well, today's Call of Duty, back then it was Mortal Kombat, Street Fighter, that kind of thing. I remember I wrote this one story when I was about 8 or 9 years old, and my actual teacher, she basically turned around and she was like, this is the first story's adults actually written where it's more emotional and written about a completely different character setting. It was something to do with a museum, is all I remember. And that gave me an inspiration to keep writing. The problem was I was really slow to write. I'd take ages to write a whole page of anything because I had so much perfectionism that if I actually made a single mistake on the last thing on a page was the full stop and I put the full stop in the wrong place, I would rip that page apart and start again. Like, I wouldn't even erase it, I'd just rip it out and start again.
So you're highly self-critical?
Very. Like, very self-critical. I was younger, but again, there were other influences towards that. My parents were sat down after I did my SATs in year 6, and my parents were told, your son, yeah, he's quite bright. He knows what he's doing. The only problem is that he writes very slowly. You might want to get some help to help him increase speed of writing. Time I was 12 at this point, and my parents basically, thankfully, my dad basically started telling me that, hey, he could walk at this point. He had his own thing going. And it was, hey, you should write stories about what we do here at work. So I would start writing stories for his company, imports and exports. I'd help him out where I could. And my commute, like about a year later, my parents separated for a short while and got back together. But my commute changed from 40 minutes a day to 2 hours a day on 2 buses. So I understood when I had time at school, like in between, I didn't like talking to new people, again, social anxiety. So I'd start writing. And that's really when it began, when I was 12. I started to write stories every single day for about 2 hours on the bus.
What kind of stuff did you write about?
Anything I could get my eyes on, like anything I could get my hands on. At the time, the biggest influence we had like growing up where I grew up was the very hip-hop culture of the early 2000s. So a lot of the stories revolved around that, or music companies, or where my imagination could go and where I could take myself. Or what would happen on the basketball court, because I played basketball, or what happened at the gym, or which Thai boxer or fighter I really liked to or admired. So I'd write stories about those people around me, but also for my dad, I'd write about what was going on at his work. Yeah. So I'd write about how Peter like really had a great family, like how his kids were absolutely wonderful and were really grateful that their dad had a job, but particularly that their dad's job was actually inspecting different pieces of hardware and circuitry to make sure that the exports that we were shipping out were all functional and well working to go to other happy families. And that was something that I was writing about, and my dad would just read it. And I kept this practice up through going through poetry phases, going through a very embarrassing hip hop phase of my life, and then kind of like rounding out as I got older into just understanding how people think and movies and like documentaries and seeing how people can tell their stories even better. So it's always been like in my mind to actually write in that way. And again, when I was 18, shortly again after I met you guys, when I got back from that seminar, my dad actually, I told him I was going to be a copywriter. My dad pulled out a file and goes, "Hey, these are all the stories that you wrote for me." Well, I didn't say that. He was like, "Read these and see if they look familiar." I read them and he was like, "Yeah, these are all the stories that you wrote for us over the years. We collected them, sent them over to our copywriter to basically edit them, put a headline and subheadline together, and mail them out." So it was like, you just got a really good knack for this kind of thing. So you
Well,
should.
so he'd been using it as like sales copy. You've been writing these stories and then you've been converting it into sales letters.
And when I asked him, "Where's my damn royalty check?" he just looked at me and said, "Do you want an ass whooping?" And I was like, I'll take the woman's shelter. It's fine. Thanks, Ed."
So you're a highly creative guy. You've got a highly active imagination, yeah.
Yes, very much so.
And visually, in terms of art, as well as with words.
I've started taking up art classes this year. Well, not classes so much. I got an iPad with the Apple Pencil, not the Pro, but the 9.7, just so I could sit at home and just do some artwork for whatever I wanted to do. Just, sit down, watch some Bob Ross, and just do some painting.
Right. Did you say iPad? I didn't hear what you said.
I use an iPad, so I use a lot more digital artwork now than I do with a canvas. Mainly because you don't get much space in London to do so.
Right. And so when did you begin that?
Around the same age that my parents separated, it was a year later, I was 13. Unfortunately, following a very, very, very bad basketball incident where I was stabbed, which wasn't fun.
What?
My yeah, like I grew up in a really messed up neighborhood, so like I got stabbed on the basketball court by some kid's older brother. There's a whole long-winded story behind it, but it was quite racist, unfortunately.
What part of London's this?
Oh, it wasn't in London. It was in Leicester, of all places,
Okay.
which was weird because Leicester's a very multi-ethnic and multi-religious community. But this was like an area in the 2000s that was still like the last remnants of quite racist people around you. And we'd moved there for some reason. I don't know why. But my mom was like, "Yeah, this seems like a good area. We should go here." I was playing basketball and. Basically I got stabbed by the 17-year-old. I was 13 and everything kind of evened out. It was fine, but my mom was completely terrified, so she enrolled me in kickboxing classes. There was a kickboxing class that was a 6-week introduction course. It was full contact because we tried to get me into karate before when I was like 9, and I think I made fun of the instructor the entire time. I kept mocking all his all the sounds he was making when he was punching. He didn't like me very much for that. He's like,
Oosh, oosh.
"Kia," and I just no. He's like, "Kia," I'm like, "Seriously, man, why?"
Hi-ya.
Just literally would straight up like heckle him and be like, "But why are you making the noise?"
Yeah. Hey, by the way, do you watch any of the McDojo Life stuff, like the stuff that mocks all the kind of
Oh, the America Dote stuff.
yeah, do you know what I mean? That have you seen that channel?
The one on where Master Ken. Is that what you're on
There's,
about?
there's, they always post like really silly videos of crazy martial art energy stuff, you know, where like some chi master's throwing energy balls and everyone explodes and, you know.
Oh, sometimes I do watch those. There's a really good channel on YouTube called it's called Enter the Dojo or Ameridote. If you search either one or even Master Ken,
Right.
it's just this American dude who is like, "I am a 10th degree black belt in Ameridote," which is his own martial arts system. And he legit makes fun of it, like makes fun of everything. He was like, "I see a lot of martial artists do this like hand over fist motion like they do in Wing Chun, Jeet Kune Do. It's like, it's dumb. It doesn't teach you anything. Let me show you how it's done." And he's like, "You want to go left center? Okay, left, center, right. And basically at the end of it, he's making you do patty cake.
Oh,
And
right.
he's taking it so seriously, it's
That
hilarious.
rings a bell. I think I might have seen that one. So it was kickboxing that you got into.
Yeah, and then a couple of months later, someone grabbed me. When I say grabbed me, basically pulled me aside and was like, "Hey, why aren't you doing Thai boxing?" I was like, "Why?" They're like, "Thai boxing is far more fitted for your frame." So I thought, "All right, cool." So I started doing Thai boxing and really got into it. Had a couple of competitions. It was fun. And then when I started getting older, I started like competing, getting a little bit, a few more fights here and there. Because for a short period, I did live abroad. And I had a couple of fights over there, so that was
You
fun.
mean competitive
Yeah,
competitions?
like actual fights where you'd go in and fight another person. It was a lot of fun.
But ties when you can do elbows and knees as well, is that right?
Exactly, but you can't do elbows in the Western world. You can only do knees. And depending on what division it is, if it's like A class or C class or it's amateurs, or even S class, you can't really do knees to the face. So you can only the body and the legs,
Right.
which was a bit of a disadvantage for me, considering I really didn't like boxing when I was younger. I used to hate punching people in the face.
Oh, I see. So the more you can use your knee, the more comfortable you are with
Yeah,
that. Right.
more my legs. The more I can use my arms to tie you up and just tie you out and just knee you and kick you, I'd be happy. But I actually stopped doing that after a spinal injury, which wasn't fun. I got thrown into a corner. My back kind of went funny afterwards and fully recovered now, but like back then it was really, really painful.
Right.
And at 24, after taking about 3 years away from martial arts, decided to try it again and took up jiu-jitsu, well, Brazilian jiu-jitsu. And I've been doing that since. So like this is my fifth year because I took a year out. So we'll be going into my fifth year of doing Brazilian jiu-jitsu.
How many times a week do you train?
Right now, well, the January, January till March hasn't been the most consistent because I've been really busy with stuff. But usually I train about 3 to 4 times a week, doing jiu-jitsu, and then it's weights and lifting about 4 times a week as well.
I've dabbled. I mean, I've spent a lot of time doing dance and yoga and gymnastics, and I've always been interested in movement and the body, and I've dabbled a little bit in martial arts. Like I went to boxing one summer for a bit, and I had a few goes at Brazilian jiu-jitsu, and I went to a few different kickboxing. So I never got into it seriously, but I just had a go at a few different classes kind of. And it's like I always liked the idea of it. I like the idea of being good at it, and I believe if I committed my time to it, I would get good at it because I tend to learn things quite quick. But like for me, I just can't seem to. I don't really think I need it in my life. I mean, I feel like I got enough hobbies and enough projects and enough things to focus on. It's like, I just can't, just don't really feel like I need it. It's not a high priority for me enough to sort of commit myself to it, you know?
Yeah, oh, I totally agree with you. Like, it's really down to what you feel comfortable with doing. And what's really, I'm going to say annoying. What's really annoying is that if you actually ever did Brazilian jiu-jitsu, like seriously, you'd be the person that gets good really, really quickly because you already have like a background in dance and in yoga and in movement. So I'm like, you're the person that we'd all want to be like, can we not train with Ben? Why? Because it's just really good, really fast, and it annoys us, but in the best of ways.
I guess you're the kind of guy that learns stuff quickly as well, I'd imagine.
To a degree, my problem has seemingly always been, apparently, according to like my jiu-jitsu instructors, they're like, "You're really nice on the mats. It's really annoying." I
Right.
was like, "Why?" They're like, "You're not that aggressive when you train. Like, you're super nice about people and let them pass your guard." And I'm like, "Yeah, but that's because I know I'm in no real danger." And they're like, "Yeah, but that's a bad habit. You need to like change that in training. Yes, you need to be able to be calm, but you also need to be able to like show a little bit of assertiveness." I was like,
So
"Ew."
does it stem from that stabbing incident? Is that the singular reason why you enjoy training martial arts, or is there other factors as well?
That was the initial reason. The other fact is that it's like meditation for me. It's the one place I go where I know when I'm on the mats, I'm completely disconnected from the world. Like that is the place that I am the most present, because I don't have my phone either, so that's always nice. So I don't have my phone, I don't have any Wi-Fi, I don't have Facebook, emails, nothing. I don't have what's gonna happen 10 minutes from now. well, that's a lie. I do have what's going to happen 10 minutes from now, but I don't have like what happens, you know, after class. I don't have that thought. The only reason I think what's happening 10 minutes from now, I'm like, okay, who's my training partner today and how are we going to do this? Because if I end up with Greg, who I love, but Greg is genuinely about 43 kilos heavier than me. So I'm like, if I've got Greg, what is my strategy? Because if I try and move him, the man's like a mountain. He pulls me, I go flying. I try and pull him. It's like, it looks like a child trying to move like a really heavy person. It doesn't work. Even especially when he's like taunting me, we're going, come on, that'll do something. I'm like, I am doing something. I just can't do it to you. So that's what I mean. But like for me, it's 100% just a way for disconnect. It's like disconnecting. Like it's for you. Why do you love to dance?
It's just a nice feeling. Hey, I'm curious, like, I get the impression that in martial arts clubs, it's very often like normal guys like us, kind of intellectual kind of guys that sort of want a challenge, they want a problem to solve, you know, they like to push themselves. I get the impression it's not necessarily like meat, aggressive, angry meatheads. What's your experience of that?
It's usually not, but what's funny is that you do get a couple of like angry, aggressive meatheads at the start, and then they calm down. Like, they calm down very quickly. Main reason is because they get like, if they get tapped out by a person that's smaller than them, or they get tapped out by a girl, or if they get completely humiliated, if they feel like it humbles you very quickly. So you end up in a humbled state of mind, and the people that stay there and train, they're not the most arrogant people in the world. They're actually very, very nice, like you and I. They're just a lovely bunch of people to spend time with. And a friend of mine said this best to me a couple of years ago. It was like, yeah, me and my friend were just talking about this. So like, we wouldn't hang out with some of the guys that we train with if we didn't train together. Like, we would never like made our way to walk over to them like, hey Ben, nice to meet you. My name's Adil. We wouldn't do that if we were in real life. We would only do that in the gym. And now, because we've made that relationship and friendship with someone that's from a completely different circumstance and idea of mindset, you kind of don't have that ego as in to say, like, I drive an amazing car, or I have an amazing life, or my life is shitty. On the mats, it's all equal. It's like, how good are you in your skills? And if someone asks you for help, you give it to them.
I mean, have you ever been in a situation where you've had to use it?
Yeah, several times. My Thai boxing more so than my jiu-jitsu. I've never really had many reasons to. The only time I really did was I was walking home from a skate park like 4 years ago, 3, 4 years ago. A really late night. It was 1 in the morning. I was walking back, had my skateboard in my hand, just walking through London, and someone came up and actually punched me in the back of the head. That was like the only time I've ever had to like really kind of like restrain them, get them to the ground, put them in a position where they can't move, and just go, you better stop now or else I'm going to break something. And then they just immediately stop because they realize their shoulder is locked in a certain position. And they're like, oh crap, he can really hyperextend and rip my shoulder apart. I'm like, yeah, I could.
Isn't it weird how it's like it's dickheads that don't know how to fight that are more like the loose cannons that are more likely to do something stupid,
And start a fight, yeah.
and then the guys that know how to fight, like yourself, that train, like I don't, you know, I feel perfectly comfortable about you know, people that train kickboxing, they're not gonna start a fight. It's the people that don't know how to start a fight that are gonna like sucker punch you or, you know, maybe stab you or something stupid.
Yeah, agreed. It's an old instructor of mine told me about this. He goes, the more you understand how to break and fight the human body, the more you don't ever want to do that to anyone. Like, it's just that you're so just in a state of knowing that I could kill you any moment I want. I'm just not going to. That there is no point to.
And like anyone who's got the discipline and patience to get good at anything, whether it's martial arts, whether it's bodybuilding, whether it's painting,
Yoga.
anything, like that's a certain kind of like there's a certain quality and a certain intelligence to a person that gets good at anything, because it's a long-term thing, isn't it? You know, there's like with bodybuilders in a way, there's a certain stigma with that. But actually, you know, there's a lot of qualities about bodybuilders because they got the ability to delay gratification for a long-term result that they're working towards. And, you know, there's a lot of elements of intelligence and self-control in that. You know, you can't be an idiot and get good at anything, really, you know?
Agreed. I mean, you really can't. There is no, those two things cannot correlate in the same place where you don't have that level of discipline, that level of understanding that, you know, you, as you so eloquently put, sorry, I just had a like brain fart right there. So eloquently put it as they have delayed gratification. They understand how to be patient. They understand that, you know, if they want to get a certain result, they can. And I realized this as well with dancers, particularly. They have a lot of resilience and a really high threshold for pain. Yeah, like you guys are kind of crazy for doing so. Like ballerinas, especially. Like any time that I've, because I did, when I was younger, I did get told to do ballet for a couple of months to help my hip flexors. Which now I've realized saying out loud publicly for the first time that people are going to know about that. That'll be fun.
I love
But
ballet.
oh yeah, it's amazingly good for your core. It's great for your hip flexors and your legs and your balance. But back then, again, being a 14-year-old, I didn't really want everyone to know, so that was always fun. But what I find is how brutal their workouts are. I have like no idea. Like before that, even every so often now, when I forget, I'm like, yeah, you did ballet. I respect you. Now I've got more respect for them. But like back then, it was like, oh, ballet isn't so hard. Did ballet. It's so hard.
Oh yeah, I love the precision and control and elegance of it. Yeah, it's yeah, the alignment, the posture is so precise. You know, it's a great challenge.
Yeah.
Oh, I'll tell you what, you want a challenge? Try pole dance.
I actually will. How about that? I actually will do that. The only thing is I need to find I would need to find a thing. It's like, because I'm moving very soon, so I'm actually going to be looking for a place out where in East London that I can actually find that does that, because I believe it'll be really good for my core.
It's difficult as fuck. It hurts. The main thing is it hurts, right? Like, because when you do thigh grips on the pole, your skin is sort of clutching the bare pole, and it kind of burns. It kind of hurts. It's sort of tearing your skin, and over time you get desensitized to it. But it's really, really, and you know those girls when they're doing their stuff and making it look easy, like is not easy at all.
Wow. Okay, so I gotta ask, do I have to shave my legs?
I don't think so. No. I trained at several different, because the thing is, because I teach handstands and a lot of pole dancers come to my handstand classes because they want to incorporate handstands into their pole routine. So I end up in pole dance studios quite regularly. And so, yeah, I've been in those environments quite a lot in different places and taken. No, I don't think you'd have to shave your legs, but. And
That's good.
also one of the main things with dance, and it's probably the same with martial arts as well, is flexibility and range. Like the people that are more flexible find it all much easier. Like all those body positions you need to get in and the back bends and everything, like the bendier you are, the easier it is, you know?
Yeah, I'm thankful I actually have hypermobility in most of my joints.
Right.
So I get to really play with that quite a bit.
Right.
But it's definitely, hold on one moment. Yeah, it's definitely one of those things I really have to say that I'm fortunate to have, but I'm not really sure if I really take it for granted as much as I could. But
Oh man.
I think it would definitely help out in when I'm pole, if I when I take pole dancing classes.
For sure. Like I guess if you're on the ground grappling doing jiu-jitsu, like if you do a hip thrust where you're pushing your hips up in the air and you go into a back arch position, I'm guessing that can be an advantage for you, can it?
It definitely could. Sorry, my voice is going to sound a little bit different because I just found out that I was recording on my regular mic and not my actual microphone that I use on for interviews. Sorry.
Okay, you're crystal clear to me, don't worry.
Oh, perfect. So I was going to say it does help in those positions, but so my hypermobility is quite severe in most of my limbs. So it definitely helps when someone's trying to go for a knee bar, or they're trying to go for a shoulder lock, or they're trying to go for an arm bar, and they just see that my arm pops out a little bit further than it should, and my shoulder goes a little bit further back than it really, like a normal person's does. So it gives me that extra couple of seconds where they have that doubt and thought, as in, okay, can I, do I really want to go for this? Can I really do this? Am I going to hurt this person? Because everyone thankfully has that attitude of, we don't want to put the submission on full force to snap the limb.
Yeah.
We want to put it in a position where we give the other person a chance to tap out.
Yeah.
Once they tap out, you let go. And because they get to that point where most people will tap out and I'm just hanging on, like I'm just chilling out here, this is fine.
Yeah.
It gives me a couple of seconds to actually move my legs around, move my hips around, bend my back a little bit further than it needs to, for the bridge, and just helps me get the position I need. So it does help out.
Yeah.
Though the downside is once your training partners realize that you're flexible, you kind of almost lose that right away, and you have to start relying on the technical side of things that you've basically built into your game.
Right, because they learn they can push your arm further before it starts hurting.
Yeah, they're just like, ah, got you. I was like, damn it, no.
Right.
It still hurts.
So earlier on, you said you're coming back to comedy and you're doing it again or something. Is that what you said?
Yeah, definitely. I'm starting to do some comedy gigs this year in London. And it's going to be a lot of fun because, like, last year, so 2018 was like a rough year for me. Just in like my own business world and really trying to find myself. And over the course of time, I'm actually basically getting to know myself more over the last 2018 and doing some really much deeper work than I've done before. I found that the thing that made me feel drained was that I was never showing my creativity to the world.
Mm.
Like I'd create things and rarely post them on Facebook, rarely show them off on social media, rarely show them to any other human but myself, even though I wanted to. Mm. And it wasn't from a place of like, oh, I want to because I need attention. It was more of a case of I want to because I want to share my joy. And I never did that. So this year I made a promise to myself at the end of December, as I started getting more and more vulnerable, getting more and more in touch with my feelings, that I want to do something that's creative. And I thought, what's a really creative avenue for me? I was like, well, I love telling stories. Let's go back to doing some stand-up. So yeah, and I started to write new material out, like so much new material has come up to me, like from ridiculous stories that I see on day-to-day things to ideas and sketches that I could actually draw out and run with.
This interests me as well. Like, how do you learn? Is there a format to comedy? Can you learn it? Is there books you study? Is there courses?
You can learn it, but I've never gone through that.
Okay.
There are a couple of comedians I know that do teach the average person how to tell good stories to get laughs. I realized it's the way that I have an inflection. And it's a perspective thing. So the best thing I can ever tell anyone, or even you, if you ever do decide to do comedy, is find a story that you find quite funny or quite morbid. And while you tell it, show the observations. Like when you look back at it and go, oh, that is so messed up.
Yeah.
Like, don't be afraid to go there. Like, so if you want, I can actually just give you like a really quick example of something like this.
Sure.
So like a really quick example. Was I was watching Spider-Man, like the original 90s Spider-Man, and I started just thinking about, like, okay, so what about, like, Fisk, his henchmen? Like, do they all live in the building with him, like, the entire time? Like, because 90s cartoons never made sense. Like, every time there was an attack, like, this horde of henchmen would show up.
Yeah.
And it's always made me wonder, do they all, like, live at barracks together? Are they always in armor? Do they take shifts off? Like, are they at home and they're just wondering, like, I'm sorry, honey, like, Spider-Man can attack at any time, so I've got to go back to work. So they basically, even, they have to do everything. They have to shower their armor on, they have to make love to their wife with their armor on, or their husband, depending, you never know. You can just imagine one of them just has to take a poop sometime. They're taking a shit, and, like, they've got their armor on, and, like, the bell goes off that Spider-Man's attacked. They have to run out of the bathroom and get into the field to, like, try and apprehend him. Just stuff like that comes up to me. And I wrote up, that wasn't like the entire bit, but like I wrote a whole bit about how it starts off with that and just continued back into the regular theme they had in my show about the story about my parents.
Right. I see. So is it a case of like when you think of an idea or something funny occurs to you, you write it down and keep a list of notes or something?
Only if I've told someone. Usually it's when I'm on the phone with someone, I'm telling them something, and they start laughing uncontrollably, that I just start writing it down. like again, just a complete a better example of this would be like talking to my friend Ellie, and she and I were basically discussing how my newborn niece, like cuddling her, and I don't know how we got onto the subject about talking about MDMA, and we were just like, because I was like, what would it feel like, and so on. She goes, oh, you just feel really happy. And she was like, but whatever you do, never pick up a baby when you're on this drug. I was like, why? Because again, hadn't done it, and curious to know why she told me not to do that if that was a thing that would happen. She goes, oh, because you'd want to like touch it and squeeze it because it feels so soft. I'm like, yeah, and knowing my luck, if I ever did do this, I'd be the idiot that basically like pushes the baby's soft spot, and in one fell swoop, I've been disconnected from my family, and now I'm the drug story that you tell to your kids. Like, oh, you better. Everyone has that drunk or drug story. It's like, I knew someone at school, they smoked weed that one time, and then now they're in a mental hospital. I would be the one that gets that story. It's like, oh, you know your uncle Adil. He did drugs that one time, and he killed your niece. And I'm like, what, he killed his niece, like killed your cousin. I'm like, what? How did I become the drug story in the family? So just stuff like that. It's like that came up as an idea, and I just decided to write it down. And it's not even a real bit. It's just an idea for a bit that I want to create out of.
And how long is your set gonna be?
The first one's usually 5 to 10 minutes,
Right.
because I'm basically starting out with new material, like from the very, very start again, like using none of the old stuff I used to use. And so it's like a 5 to 10 minute set, see how the crowd reacts to it and responds to it, and then go from there.
Do you like what other comedians do you admire or do you like their style?
There are a lot, mostly Americans though. Like, I like the British comedians, I do, but what I find with British comics is they're really funny and on point, and I just love them, or they're just annoying and cheesy, and I'm like, how would anyone find you funny? Like, no offense to him, but Joni Vegas or Vargas or whatever his name is, that dude, I'm like, your stories just freak me out. I don't know why you're funny. But at the same time, it's all about, for me, it's just what I used to laugh at when I was younger, which was the racial humor. I now laugh at the stories. Like, for instance, I can go back and watch Chris Rock's work from up to 2003, but anything after that, I'm not a fan of his work anymore.
Right, why not?
It just doesn't sit, it doesn't make me laugh like it used to. Like when I watch Bigger and Blacker, or watch his just or any of his like hit Bring the Pain, any of those comedy sets I watch, I will laugh so hard at, because it just reminds me of I understand where they're coming from in that time. Whereas they've not evolved their material to what is today's standards, and because of that, it doesn't have that same weight like it used to if it's told in today's world.
Do you mean it needs to have like even more shock factor today, or what do you mean?
I don't mean shock factor, it just needs to come from a more genuine place. Like, it's the equivalent of a 50-year-old using the same material they did when they were 30. I'm like, your material hasn't evolved. So it just doesn't sit right with me. Like, I can't laugh at that. And someone that's really good at watching the evolution of their comedy is someone like Bill Burr. Because Bill Burr, his early comedy was always brilliant, but you can see the progression of how he's become a better storyteller, and how he basically brings the crowd in, and how he shares his opinions while pissing the crowd off at times, but then calling them out for being pissed off at something. So I'd say my top 10 list of, actually, I'll give you what, my top 5 list of comics that I like right now, and my top 5 all-time list, because there are two differences. Current list, Joe Rogan, love him, think his storytelling is absolutely brilliant. Triggered is one of my favorite things, it makes me laugh all the time. Tom Segura, Bert Kreischer, goodness, who else would I actually put on that? Bill Burr, obviously, number 4, but in no particular order. And I'd say, I can't really think of a British comic that I've seen lately that's made me laugh really hard.
When you listen,
John Richardson. Let's put John Richardson on the list.
Okay, I knew the three of those, but I'll have to look up the other two. When you hear other comics, are you thinking in terms of the structure of what they're saying and the process of their story structure? Like, do you analyze it like that or not?
No. Well, yes and no. Sorry, I should be. When I watch it, I enjoy it. When I think about why I enjoy it, I understand the process of what they went through.
Right.
So it's only in retrospect, in the moment, I'm completely immersed in their world and laughing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's
So.
very appealing. Like, it's a great challenge, isn't it? The idea of like being out there and making people laugh and the risk of like, bombing and
Bombing.
not being funny. Like, and martial arts the same, there's a lot at stake, isn't there? You win, there's the glory of the victory, or there's the pain and humiliation of losing. It's like it's real high stakes games, isn't it, in a way?
Pretty much, but same goes to copywriting. Same go in my and same with dancing and yoga or anything that you really are passionate for that you take forward. Unless you're willing to accept the fact that you will possibly or most likely probably lose at some point, or someone will get the better of you, or something very challenging will come your way to actually see what to test your mettle. If anything like that, if you cannot accept that reality, don't do it. Because the first time you're faced with adversity, that's when it's really going to show up. And like, again, I like to use this as jiu-jitsu as a perfect vehicle for this. I think Joe Rogan said it best, but I think he got it from someone else as well, which is, what is jiu-jitsu? It's essentially high-level complex problem-solving with dire consequences. And that is the formula for anything. If you're not prepared to like eat shit and bomb on stage, excuse my language, and do stand-up comedy, if you're not willing for it, then don't do stand-up. Like, my first gig back, I decided to enter the gong contest at the Comedy Store in London. The thing
I don't
is,
know what that is. What do they hit a
oh,
gong?
yeah, but here's the thing. There are three judges. The judges are the crowd, and the crowd has come for blood. There is no, basically the best way I can describe it, the Boston night of comedy. A Boston night of comedy is you versus the crowd. No one goes home the winner. Like, either you go home crying because they won, or they go home laughing because you made them cry. Like, it's one or the other. Like, they are merciless. And the same thing happened here. Like, professional comedians that would otherwise do like 30-minute sets were being booed off stage in 15 seconds.
Really, because the crowd is because it's like a how do you
It's
describe it? Like a it's a like a I want to say gauntlet of fire. I don't know if that's the right way of saying it.
A baptism of
But
fire is
yeah.
what you're going for. Like, to give you an idea, someone actually said, so I recently bought a book on Amazon about suicide, and someone in the crowd just yelled out, "Kill yourself." Like,
Oh,
without
I
missing
see.
a
So,
beat.
oh, I see. So the crowd have got free rein to like heckle you and roast you whilst you're doing your set. Is
Yeah.
that it?
Oh yeah, and then when I went up, I completely drew blank and screwed up my joke and got booed off. I was like, I
So
lasted 25 seconds.
what do they call that? That's a Boston thing, is it?
I call it a Bo it's a Boston crowd. I call it a Boston crowd because when I was in the States when I was 21, I got told this by an older comic. He was like, "Dude, yeah, Boston crowd is basically you versus the crowd."
Oh, I see, right. So they're just real harsh there, are they?
Yeah, like it's why a lot of the best comedians come from that type of area. So if you look at like Louis C.K., George Carlin, Joe Rogan, who I've mentioned a couple of times on this already, Bill Burr as well, and like that's just four really big comics that have come through Boston. Even though Carlin's technically from New York, he played in Boston a lot. Just kind of like even Doug Stanhope, like all these guys are from that time. But what I was going to say was, like, as far as it goes, like, again, this is just a very quick list. So I only just remembered the quick list of like my top five all greats that I reckon everyone should listen to, especially if they want to understand how to use stories. George Carlin would reign number one for me. Richard Pryor, Bill Hicks. Oh, God, that's like my top three. I'd put Eddie Murphy and Dave Chappelle on that list. But Eddie Murphy, Delirious, not Raw. Everyone loves Raw. I think Delirious is better. Yeah,
I don't
he's.
specifically remember them. I may have seen them a long time ago.
If you ever got like a day where you're just like, okay, I want something in the background. I don't want to do anything. I just want to heal and relax and laugh. Stick one of their bits on, and you'll have a great night of laughter. Like you just won't be able to stop at times.
Do you watch live comedy routinely?
Not as routinely. Well, yeah, I do, but it's mostly recorded. So like Netflix shows or whatever. But if there's a good comedian in London that I really want to go see, I'll get tickets to go see them.
Hey, earlier on you talked about 2018 being a tough year, and you said
Yeah.
you'd gone through some stuff and worked on yourself, and like, I mean, do you want to
Yeah, we
go
can
into
definitely
that?
talk about that for sure. But yeah, 2018 was, I think it was a tough year for most people. Like, I don't think I've spoken to a single entrepreneur. That's a lie. I've spoken to one entrepreneur who had a good year. Everyone else I spoke to in 2018 was like, dude, this is like a terrible year. We have no idea what's going on.
My sales were shit in 2018.
Wait, were yours as well?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like everyone's was. Like, I think I made a, I lost a 33% of my profit margin from the year before.
Right.
Yeah, it's
Yeah.
crazy.
And then, like, so did you do some kind of like personal development or some kind of spiritual work? I wasn't sure what you meant.
Oh, okay. So, what I did was I went through a transformation process that a friend of mine calls reboot.
Okay.
And we went through it, so reboot with a BOOT. So he went through that, and so I went through that with him, and essentially I found the reason why I'm here, which is basically more of a sense of inspiring myself and others around me across the world to feel more embraced, happy, wanted, loved, and empowered. And I realized that up until that moment, I played out parts of that without thinking about it, and then for some reason, this was in March 2018, so it's up to like 1 year now though since the work. And I went through this process, and the rest of 2018 was just constantly like up and down. I don't know if I want to write anymore. Do I want to? Do I not? Do I have to? I don't know. It was an up and down, dragged out fight of not knowing what I wanted to do and how I was going to deliver this message. It wasn't until actually, it didn't stop until like December at the end of 2018 when I had a conversation with a friend of mine about how to overcome it. But when I went through the self-development work, a lot of it was kind of like going through the whole emotional process of like, okay, you're really guarded. You're not bringing your walls down. You don't share your vulnerability. You don't share your experiences. You don't talk to people about what you've gone through, to help them, because a lot of people, and I know you've got a very similar mindset to me on this, is the people that publicly post their authentic stories, but they're using them as marketing ploys because they're not really authentic. They're just written as if they were. And that pisses me off. I know, if I remember correctly, it pisses you off as well.
Yeah, because you can just tell, can't you? It just feels contrived. There's a difference in there from something that's genuine or something that's got an agenda.
Agreed. It's also the same people that post, and this is nothing wrong with them because I know some of them are writers and they don't have this thing where they can like quantify what they want to say in a short space of time, and with some of them it's real. But I find it a little disconcerting when I see someone post like an essay every day about what they're feeling, and at that point I'm like, how do you have the time to write an essay? It's like 6 pages long. I'm like, I summarize my emotions too. I'm feeling this way today. This is how I feel about it. I'll write about it, and I'll get maybe half a page out of it, if that. But
It takes intelligence to be concise, doesn't it? You know, like
yeah.
rambling and not getting to the point is kind of a bit dumb in a way, you know?
It is, and it bothers me seeing people that go out there and use authenticity and vulnerability as a way to actually get people to bond with them, but it's superficiality. It's not real bond. Like, I know when I share something personal and when you share something personal, you can feel it because I know if I met Ben in person, Ben would say this shit to my face. Like, he would never back away from saying, yeah, my view is this. I mean, don't get me wrong. Yes, I'm open to having a conversation and see where your point of view comes from because I know there are points that you and I have that we would naturally just disagree to. But at the same time, I think it's also a level of respect where we just respect each other's viewpoint, be like, Yeah, that's cool. I know you're real and I'm real. We just have these different views, but we respect each other.
Yeah,
Whereas the contrived people, they don't.
that ability to have a sensible discussion. And it's like my excuse me, my point of view is I don't expect everyone to agree with me. Of course they won't. Everyone's gonna, but that ability to just have a rational, reasonable, sensible, level-headed discussion of, what the different points of view are, etc. I don't know whether that's been lost, but there's a lot of people that it's almost like a competition. Who can get the most irate? Who can get the most offended? Who can let everyone know that they're offended and upset? It's like, that's a
Oh,
different thing, isn't it?
you just want to push those people off a cliff. Like, you really do. I get it. You're offended. I love this. There was a comedian. I can't remember him. He's like a really old Australian comedian. But he's hilarious because he's also a bit of a goth as well. And he's like, what's the point? Like, everyone wants to be offended. Okay, so you're offended. Now what? It's like, be offended. But don't tell me you're offended because I'm not offended for you. I can't be offended for you because I'm not you.
This goes back to comedy as well, because I think the ability to laugh at stuff is it requires a certain level of intelligence, doesn't it? There's like it's like I think it comes down to escalation or de-escalation. Like the when you can make it's good to be able to laugh at yourself and make fun of things. And comedy serves quite an important role in a way in society because it's a space where ideas can be challenged and poked and prodded from all angles. And you can highlight the absurdities in things. And that's it's almost like digestive enzymes in the stomach. Like comedy sort of tests ideas in a way. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, agreed. It's comedy is the yellow canary in the coal mine. The day that you can't be a comic and actually speak your mind in a free public place and show the absurdity of things, that's the day when you know liberty and the liberty of freedom of speech is dying. Because you can laugh at anything. I think George Carlin said it best, and I'm using his example because it's perfect the way it is. Even though I'm like, that's a joke I personally wouldn't feel comfortable making at any point, but I would still laugh if it's like the way that he did it, which is because they say that you can't joke about rape. And he's like, well, yeah, you can. If I told you right now that Porky Pig was out and he raped Elmer Fudd, what would you laugh at that or not? And the way he delivered that entire joke, because again, it was in a comedy setting, so of course you're naturally more relaxed to laugh. He just dropped this and like went on to explain it, and that became like a really good stand-up bit. And the way that he talked about it, but at the same time, it's knowing where your point is. Like when I was a little bit more serious and doing my stand-up, I actually did a bit about how one of my friends, like years ago. How one of my friends used to say to me how she's a really, really hardcore feminist. And I'm like, well, I wouldn't say I'm a feminist. She goes, well, you don't believe in equal rights? Like, oh, I do. I just don't have a political agenda behind mine. I just believe people should be like loved for who they are and accepted as they are, even if they're a giant pain in the ass. And she's like, yeah, but we need more women in power. I was like, honey, the last time we gave women in power, divorce rates went up 50%. And she just looked at me and she went, oh my God. I was like, I know, hilarious. And she goes, that is, you should totally say that. So we wrote this whole bit, did it on stage, it worked. I tell that same joke today, I guarantee you I will be crucified. But I'd still do it.
I was going to ask you that. Has the kind of has comedy changed, like over the last
Massively.
5, 10 years? Like, how has it changed in the political climate?
It's changed because you can't tell. If you tell political jokes all the time, you're kind of lambasting yourself. You're painting yourself into a corner, and you become like everyone else. Even if you have a complete unique take on it, you're still like everyone else. You can tell things that are quite funny and great, whatever, but again, you're going after the same well of information that everyone else is. The comedy that really sticks, though, are the types of people that know they're going to offend people and give them a trigger warning before they do. Like the again, why I put Joe Rogan's one of my favorite comics. The reason why I put him on there is because the thing in trigger warning goes, this is the first time in history where I know everything I say on this special is going to get me in trouble. And he just flat out calls it out. He's like, yeah, you can say whatever. I'm going to do my jokes. And the crowd laughs. And he's like, the reason is because now they've been given a trigger warning. I'm going to say something offensive. And it's up to you whether or not you want to stay. They already know they're going to a comedy show. They already know that, like, I'm going to have, if they're very angry at him for whatever reason, they bought the tickets out of spite or whatever. I'm like, if you're there and you're doing this for that specific reason of, like, trying to become an asshole about it, once you've been given the trigger warning, that relaxes. And now you can be like, I can enjoy this and still get pissed off about this later, but I'm going to enjoy it for now. Because it's really hard to, like, hold a joy and anger in the same emotional state, at the same emotional time.
It is like mental jujitsu in a way, isn't it? You know, you're kind of, it's like a mental chess match in some ways. It's a strategy game of kind of, I don't know. Do you know what I'm getting
Yeah,
at?
it's a case of maneuvering what works where and knowing how to land it. Because if you don't stick your landing as a comic, you can fuck up a really good joke very quickly. Like, you can have the best punchline, but if it's said at the wrong moment or in the wrong inflection or too quickly or not quick enough, you could lose them. And that's where it's the way I'd even put it, instead of like conversational jujitsu, it's more like a trapeze artist, not a trapeze artist, what's the balance beam? It's like walking on a balance beam. One wrong move and you've lost it. So it takes time.
I don't know if it's my imagination. Is there kind of like a new wave or like a new opening of opportunity for comedians to start like that are really pushing back against the political correctness stuff? Like I don't know if that's just my imagination, or is that like a fresh new phase that we're coming into?
Yeah, I think we're actually starting to hit that, because we're having that arena of polarity. You have one side that's so strong as like, I'm going to not laugh at certain things, and you have the other side going, I'm going to make fun of everything you hold sacred because you're being stupid. Like there's a comedian, Hannah Gadsby, who my friends like. I personally like watch her stand up, and I'm like, I would never pay to go see you. Because it comes off a little whiny for me. I get where she's coming from. I really do. But at the same time, like one of the things I remember at least was her saying that self-deprecating humor is really bad for us because it really hurts our psyche and the way that we are. I'm like, yeah, but self-deprecating humor is basically how you get through some of the toughest things you've been through. If you can't laugh at it, if you can't laugh at yourself and laugh at what you've been through, then you're going to end up pretty sad. Because ask anyone, any I guarantee you, any comic or even copywriter, and this is a really, really key important thing, most copywriters can actually write from a range of emotions. The reason is because they've most likely felt them. Like the greatest copywriters have gone through nearly every emotional range they could, not intentionally, but through their life, through experience, through what they do. That's why they can write so well about them. There is a reason why so many, like some copywriters can write very, very well about fear and what it feels like when you're backed into a corner and when everything kind of just is not working for you and you don't know what's going to happen. You feel like you're drowning, your body completely freezes, that fight or flight or freeze response comes into play. The reason they can write about that is because they've been in that situation a bunch of times and they can relate that to another person.
It puts you at a tremendous advantage when you've had a range of experiences and you're self-aware of what you've experienced as well. Because there's a difference between having had certain emotions but kind of not being self-aware of it, where you're just controlled by your feelings. But when you can self-reflect on, you know, how certain things feel, even if they are negative, that gives you a, it's almost like a color palette to work from, isn't it? You can tell stories with greater high definition or something.
You can give it flavor. You give it a whole new different like look on what it is. And unfortunately, a lot of people can't. They just kind of have that one dimensional, I'm going to say what I can. And it's really when you can have like different, actually, the way I could best say it is you can make a piece, you can make the same food with the same ingredients with different flavors if you know what spices to use. And that's what it is you're adding spice to the actual life in front of you that you're portraying, giving, sharing, telling of. You give it different flavors. So that's basically how I see it.
So we haven't really talked about your copywriting, so tell us about that.
What do you want to know?
So is that your main job? Is that what you do mostly? Is that your primary
Yeah,
thing?
that's what I usually get hired to. Yeah, is I write copy and I consult on strategy and business, which thankfully is nowhere near as boring as it sounds, because mainly because I get to cuss my clients out, I get to call them idiots, but I also get to tell them I love them and also just have a lot of fun with them as well. One of my newer clients, we only started working together because they were on my podcast, because I do that as well on my own show, and I think you're going to be on a guest as well soon, I hope. If I haven't
Oh,
sent you a link, then that's always a thing. So I'm
great.
pretty sure I asked you, but I think we just had like a clash of scheduling, and I
All
stupidly
right.
forgot to get back to you. But anyway, so I actually only got that client because I made fun of them the entire time. And I just said to them, like, I've been trying to get you on my show for the last 4 years, and I finally got you, you asshole. How dare you evade me for so long? And he laughed so hard at that at the end of the show. He was like, dude, we need to work together. Let's see what we can do. And he became a client. But it's all literally from just having that, what's it called? Having that response and having that back and forth with people that's allowed me to actually, enjoy my copywriting work. So that's my main source of income, and that's what I love to do, is combine my love of stories with being able to sell things.
Do you combine, sorry, I mean, do you get your clients from networking in real life, or do you advertise your services? How does it happen?
I've always had my clients from referrals. Like, I meet them at networking events, I meet them at seminars, we get added to the same Facebook groups, they end up on my podcast. Basically, once I speak to someone, if it's kind of like this thing that I know that you do, and this is how I know Ben can sometimes be a bit of a softie, and I love him for it, is if you see someone that needs help that you know that you can help because you're coming from that place, it's like, I just want to help this person, you'll make it happen. Or you'll tell them what to do to like help them out in that moment. Like if someone's struggling with handstands, you'd be like, oh, cool. Yeah. Well, you just move your hand positioning over here, or this is what you want to be aware of. And you give them a little bit of advice. Whereas for me, I do the same thing with copy. It was like, if I see someone that I really, I'm like, oh, that's an easy solve. Da, da, da. Here's the answer. Because for me, I've done it so many times and for so long that it's an easy answer. But to them, it's like, it blows their mind because they never think of it that way. And eventually what ends up happening is I get that same person or someone they refer to go speak to Adil. He's amazing. Go work with him. Like pay him money. Go do this, or like buy his course, or go on a show, or listen to whatever. And I get passed around really, and I just get clients from that. So that's kind of the thing that I do. I never really needed to advertise, which is quite nice.
That's ideal. And is it a range of different kind of industries you work with? I mean, you did say already that you don't just focus
Work
on
with.
personal development stuff.
Yeah, no, I've done with about 300 different markets now. Like, I think we've gone over 300, but that was the last time I checked.
Right.
Yeah, so we've done everything from door-to-door vacuum sales, like letters to go out for them for have a demonstration person come in, to carpet cleaning, to self-development, to yoga retreats, to you name it, we've done it. Like there's very little I've not done.
What sales results are you most proud of? What had the biggest impact?
I've had some crazy ones. I've had someone's dead list that they never messaged, never emailed for like a year, come back to life with the sequence we created, and that got them an 80% conversion on a monthly continuity program. I was like, hells yes, you know how good I am. Or getting 93% conversion rates on an opt-in page for a webinar that basically prompted, I think it was Mike Filsaime and Andy Jenkins, because they owned Webinar Jam, to speak to my client, go, how the hell did you do this? And he was like, Adil did it. And like my name just got passed along. But the most impactful would have to be the suicide letter I wrote. So there was a suicide prevention company that contacted me and asked me to work with them to craft a letter and a message to go out to both parents and people who are feeling suicidal. And the letter was basically designed. Everything they'd written before had done okay, but the reason that we smashed out the ballpark for them was I actually told the story of one of my suicide attempts, and I actually like wrote it out as I felt it, as I remember it, as everything that was there. I just wrote out exactly what happened that day, and why I decided to try and kill myself, or like I felt like killing myself. I didn't really decide, I just did. Failed, but I went for it. And the impact that we got on result in that we I know for a fact we saved at least 100,000 lives. Like with
Well,
this one letter, so I was like, that's a result I'm happy of. That's something, that's the reason why I do what I do. So I had 100,000 people respond back to this ad to ask for more information, get into counseling, get into help, understand what they need to do, how they can help their loved ones, how they can basically make their homes a little bit more safe. I mean, the number went higher than that, but I mean, like 100,000 was the number that was given to me at the end. It's like 100,000 people, you've saved 100,000 lives. And then it went on to do more, which is great, but that's the ones I remember.
how old were you
Which one? Like when I wrote it or when I tried to kill myself?
when you tried to kill yourself?
15, 16.
Okay.
So that was attempt number 4 or 5, I think. I went to 7, and the last one was about 18.
Do you
So.
want to tell us about that? I mean, you don't have to.
Oh, no, I don't mind. It's totally fine. So I have bipolar type 1 depression. So I have bipolar depression type 1, which is the suicidal one.
Okay.
And growing up, because your hormones are all over the place and stress and stuff like that, you really want to do stupid things to yourself. Like the smallest things could trigger you. I think, like to give you an idea, not even I think, to give you an idea of this, it's kind of like that experience in particular was I had an amazing week beforehand at school, and someone had made fun of me over something that was made fun of me at school about. They're like, oh yeah, the big nose. That used to really weird me out. Now I'm like, that's such a stupid thing to be annoyed by. What was I doing for all those years when I was a teenager? But hey, teenage mind. Apparently, that right there sparked a thing that basically led to me about 3 days later standing on top of a car park and jumping off of it. I was like, wow. That was the thing that basically triggers it. And like with bipolar depression, it's the smallest thing. Like you'll reach mania at times, depending on how your self-esteem is. If you have good self-esteem and have this as well, your mania reaches a point where you basically think you're a deity. You're untouchable, unstoppable, everything is perfect. You basically feel like you've got the cheat codes to life. The crash is always equivalent to the mania. So if you have like a ridiculously high mania, prepare for a very hard landing. I think after the first couple, my brain started to go, okay, we need to curb this mania. Anytime it comes up, we need to slow it down so the downside isn't too bad. And unfortunately, at the time, I didn't have a lot of control of it, or I didn't really understand it. Once I started to understand it and thankfully start healing myself through self-love and so on and so forth, that I don't really have that many, I don't have those episodes come back to me. And when they do, they're very mild. Like, I don't have that whole feeling where I let this, like, let anything get me too buzzed. Well, that's a lie. That lets me, I feel it emotionally fully without it kind of going over the mark of mania. So it's not that I'm scared of it anymore. I just understand that it doesn't affect me anymore. But yeah.
And what's your belief? Like, is it just like a random genetic thing that we, some of us are just that way, or is it stuff that happened?
I reckon the more I think about it and the more I read about it, it's a combination. You have some people that are naturally born that way because if you look at their father or their mother, depending, they'll have it. So if I remember correctly, the theory was that it's only passed down paternal, like in the sense of like father to son and mother to daughter, never father to daughter or mother to son, is the way that I was told. That could be complete BS, but that's the way I was told about it. I was like, oh, okay. So some people I do believe it is a chemical imbalance, but the majority of people, I think it's actually repression. It's like heavy duty repression and stress, and combined with high functionality of the brain, that's what causes it. At least from what I've seen in preliminary results from my own tests and my own scans, I only seem to hit that point once I've actually depleted my brain's natural lithium oxide resources, because then my brain starts to engorge and get larger, and then it snaps back down to size.
So there's a
Unfortunately, I'll go.
there's literally a physiological response during these episodes, is there, in the brain that you can observe?
to some people. I've only ever done it to my own. I've never really done it to others, so I can't really claim it as factual. I can only claim it from what I've seen.
So how did that work? Did you have a brain scan or something?
One of my friends is such and so. They used to always let me go. Like, I was like, dude, I'm having this thing. Let me go into the machine. So, like, they did a brain scan. They showed me. But it was interesting because, like, I came back when I was sad as well, and I was like, dude, I'm feeling it. Like, I'm coming down. I need, like, I'm falling. I'm in free fall right now. Help me. So he put me back in, and he looked at it and went, oh, okay, this is what's up. Because if you look at the two differences, your brain activity is very high on one side and it's very low on the other. But you can actually see that your brain, it's engorged slightly and then reduced back down to size. It's got an inflammation and it's just reduced.
So what was that? Did you say there was like a chemical or a hormone? What was it you said?
Lithium dioxide,
I've never heard of
or
that. What is it?
lithium dioxide is what you're given. As one of the treatments that at least you were given early on for bipolar depression. And unfortunately, one of the side effects is that your suicidal tendencies go through the roof if you ever take it, until after about 6 weeks of your brain to adapt to it. If you take lithium orotate, however, your brain doesn't have psychotic breakdowns and makes you want to kill yourself. When I started looking at this a little bit more seriously and started looking at why it was lithium, I realized that your brain does, if I remember correctly, your brain secretes a certain amount of lithium that allows you to function anyway. Like, everyone has a certain amount of this metal in their mind. And it's just depletion. That's all it was. So, like, once that chemical was depleted, for me at least, it caused the growth in my brain, the inflammation in my mind.
Right, so that right, I see. Yeah, I didn't.
So
I wasn't aware of this.
if you give lithium orotate to someone or lithium dioxide to someone, if that's their actual medicine, then what that does, it starts to replace the lithium dioxide that's already in their brain. Well, the lithium in their brain. And I realized, for me at least, that was the thing that I kind of, like, narrowed it down to. So, like, anytime I felt myself kind of overworking, feeling my brain kind of like starting to hit that point where I was doing too much at one time and my brain was like running around at 15 times its speed and like trying to like see everything and speak really, really quickly, I would like breathe and calm down. Find your center, breathe and calm down. And once I calm down, sometimes I don't like sleeping much, but sometimes I'd force myself to have like a 12-hour sleep. And then I'd wake up and be like, cool, I'm ready to go. I wouldn't even work. Like, some days, like, I'd take days off from working and play with my cats and go for a walk and just do things that made me feel happy. And I'd find that I'd kind of be back onto an even keel quite quickly.
So did the medication help you?
No. I took the medication once. I hated the effects. So I started looking at natural remedies and supplements and everything I could do to deal with it. I even got to the point where I think I limited my own emotional range, so I didn't allow myself to become too happy or too sad. So I let myself kind of like have a very, very stunted emotional range for a long time,
And then,
which I do not actually recommend to anyone because it sucks.
right. And you mentioned something about repression. So what did you mean by that?
Well, I reckon that, like, at least for me, the way I look at it is that a lot of people have, we grow up with our own form of trauma that we or trauma that we repress or we don't understand, that we never really deal with, and over time that festers and angers and becomes worse and more, and we never speak about it, and then it gets to the point where it starts to rule us. And once that kind of like sets in, you're essentially giving over all your control and power of who you are over to this one underlying feeling, which actually causes sadness and pain and eventually becomes a form of bipolar depression, or being able or acting out, essentially.
Yeah, that makes sense to me. I mean, I'm not denying that there's a brain chemistry element to it at all, but I definitely think there's undealt with kind of stuff, unresolved stuff, inner conflicting beliefs is bound to be, a part of it.
Oh yeah, for sure. I mean, it's kind of like you gotta look at a little bit scientifically. Well, you gotta look at it entirely scientifically, which is in the sense of, okay, so yesterday I was feeling good, today I want to kill myself. Where does this relate? And once you start doing the hard work around it, you start realizing that the reason that you might feel this way is because that one time your dad didn't actually get you that PlayStation game that you really wanted, or this thing happened that basically made you feel completely worthless, or when you were 10 years old, some kid in the playground used to beat the crap out of you, your self-esteem never really recovered, and it's only been a downward spiral since then.
Yeah, totally. Oh, I agree completely, completely. Have you done like normal psychotherapy?
No, I did. I've done a little bit of it, but I don't like sitting in the chair and just talking. It's like I could use my time better. I could spend more time speaking to someone and being like, hey, let's talk about this thing and, find an actual strategy that works for me rather than just telling me that we need to give you some medication, or at least we need to think this about you or that about you. So traditional psychology and not psychology, psychotherapy actually can be helpful to some people, but it wasn't for me.
Fair enough. Yeah, interesting.
Yeah, I didn't think we'd be going down this rabbit hole today, but yay!
And so you're in a better place now, I gather?
Oh, far better place. Have been for a long time, and more so since going through my work with Reboot, because I just feel like I can express myself a lot more emotionally, and be truer to who I am. And something that I'll give this fair warning, I guess it's a warning, but like fair heads up to anyone that's going to go down this path. Sometimes you will lose friends. Not because they're a bad person, you're a bad person, whatever it is. It's strictly down to the fact that the person who you pretended to be for a really long time, that's who they fell in love with. And they never really got to know the real you. So sometimes you'll just lose friends along the way. Other times you'll find the best people ever and be like, how have we never met before?
Yeah, it's tricky, isn't it? If you can end up a bit trapped if all your social connections and maybe your partner as well is they all know the person that you're not.
Yeah.
And that can be a real trap situation, can't it?
Exactly, because then you've got to, do I play it safe and let everyone keep having this fallacy and belief in me, or do I become true and real and actually allow people to see the real me and hope that the right people stay?
That's really why I was quite unhappy going to yoga and stuff, because essentially I'm a business person and I'm like ambitious and pro-capitalism and I want to make money and all that kind of thing, and a lot of people in the definitely in the circus world and the yoga world, they're not orientated in that way at all. They're quite, anti-capitalist. They just want to sit on their mat and meditate and eat vegan food and go to India once a year and stuff like that. And essentially, all that stuff does not interest me. And so I felt really conflicted. Like I kind of surrounded myself with kind of hippie people, but really, my true nature is more a businessman. So I kind of got myself in a backed into a corner with that.
Yeah. And it's kind of that whole thing is like, do I continue living this, not lie, but do I live with these people around me and let them keep believing I'm one way when in reality I just want to say, guys, I actually agree with so and so, and they do have a valid point about how business should be run and how we can get ourselves out of like this, the way that the things have been screwed up, rather than kind of blaming this current system. How do we work around that system to make sure that everyone benefits and profits from it?
Yeah, like what I noticed, I started to notice, like I'd go home and I'd watch videos of like boxing or like Conor McGregor or UFC or like Mike Tyson beating the fuck out of someone or like Grant Cardone talking about some $100 million deal he just done, getting off his jet and all the swag and all the bling and Floyd Mayweather and his Rolls Royce. And I get so, like, I love all that, that lights me up. You can tell by my voice. And then I go to yoga and it's like, thinking of going surfing on the weekend, and I'm thinking I couldn't give a fuck about fucking surfing, and so yeah, I was just I got to that point where I became conscious of like, oh man, I can't be around these people, I'm just I've got a different nature,
Yeah, and it's not to say that you can't also be a yogi or a yoga person and actually not have and still have those views. I mean, it's fine, and there's nothing wrong. Like, it's kind of the whole thing. Like, I love jiu-jitsu. I do love capitalism. I think it's a great system in the way that it's built. But more importantly, like, any time that someone basically sits down and kind of goes, you know what, this fighting is violent or blah blah is bad or whatever it is, my whole thing is like, dude, you do you. I couldn't give two shits about what you do. I only care about like what I'm doing because, well, I'm doing it. If what I was doing was really detrimental and in your way, and actually you can prove to me that I was in your way and I was a really bad person, then yeah, fair enough, I'll apologize. But if what all I've done is, I don't know, enjoy the few comfort, or like one of my creature comforts or one of the things I love to do, I'm not gonna apologize about that. I'm not gonna feel bad about that. I'm gonna go do that thing. As much as you like to say that you like to surf, maybe I like to sit here and have a conversation about how we can generate a $1 million deal. Maybe that's what I want to do.
And like if you've got enough space in your life to be yourself and you feel like you're self-expressed and you're able to be yourself and people love you for who you are, then it's okay to still relate to other people with different interests. Like you said, there's nothing wrong with going to yoga as long as you're fulfilled and satisfied in your life essentially. You can still be compatible with all different kinds of people, isn't it? But it's when you've put your own self on mute in order to accommodate, different people, that's when it's a problem, isn't it?
Yeah, it would be. It's definitely going to be one of those things. It's definitely going to be one of those things where you got to be able to relate and accommodate to other people and meet them where they are, but also know your own boundaries to be like, I'm not going to be sucked into this like ridiculously weird talk that I don't agree with. Because you've seen it far off and where people are like, I want to be accepted and be with a group, and I know I'll bend my will to your way of thinking, which is the worst thing you could do.
Oh, it's devastating. If you don't feel like you can be yourself, like, I mean, that is fundamentally, I don't know what to call it. It's a problem.
It is a problem.
So, I'm aware you've got a meeting shortly, don't you? So, tell our listeners what's the best place to find you if they're interested in your work.
Well, if you guys go to my website, which is adilamarsi.com, we're currently having it rebuilt. So what's there right now is cool, but like it's gonna be more me once it's done, because like when I built the site initially, it was kind of like, yeah, I'm going to be more businessy, but like I kind of just want to show people the side of me that's like, no, I'm more fun than just this business approach that's out there. So if you guys go to adilamarsi.com, you guys can look at the blog posts that we have, the podcast you guys can check out, you can subscribe to the mailing list, you guys can do whatever the hell you want there. It's all good and well. But yeah, that's basically the best place to find me is adilamarcy.com. Or if you're on Facebook or Instagram, it's just adilamarcy and find me. Send me a message, send me a request, follow me on Instagram. Let's connect.
Hey, one more thing. Are you like a long-term goal kind of person? Like, have you got this grand
Massively.
vision? Yeah, what's your long-term sort of, what's your life's work gonna look like?
My life's work, it's kind of hard to say because it's not tangible per se, but it is. The thing that I want to leave behind as my legacy is, how do I put this in words? Because I've never been asked this question, by the way. So I genuinely really have never been asked this question. So the way I do it is, it's a feeling. And that feeling is, on my deathbed, I want to die empty. I want to die with every great thing about me done and out there. All my artwork out there, the legacy I create out there, the comedy out there, the sitcom out there, the books that I want to write out there, every little concept, idea, thought process, whatever it is that goes through my mind, out there. And I don't care what anyone else does with it. It's just that I want it out there. Because if I die wondering, what if I know I wouldn't have actually hit that goal. And the other goal I have as well is to make one person laugh every day. And I've had that goal since I was 12, and I intend to keep it until the day I die.
I love it. That's great. That's awesome. Perfectly clear.
What's yours, though, Ben? I'm curious.
Well, not greatly dissimilar to yours. I mean, yeah, that thing of doing everything you possibly could with everything you've got, being fully self-expressed, being as creative in every way that you possibly could have. I'm kind of into creation for creation's sake, like achievement for achievement's sake, just the thrill of creating and doing and accomplishing, like
So similar to me in that sense.
Yeah, that's right. I think a lot of people overthink goals. It's like a lot of people think they need some big explanation of why you want to do that and why that's going to make you happy. I don't think you do. I think it's just the thrill of the game of doing it. Like, make money and then make more money. There's no end destination. I do love, I mean, I would love to be fabulously wealthy. I do have a vision of, like properties and, I'd love to have a helicopter. I'd love those kind of trappings of wealth. I like that kind of stuff, big house, a country farm, big events, that kind of thing. I've always admired like Dana White in terms of his business empire, and also Simon Cowell. They're similar in a way because they, Simon Cowell, they're kind of the same, aren't they? They're just in different industries. And I've always wanted to end up like one of those kind of guys with like kind of famous, but not necessarily the center of attention, but, hustling behind the scenes and all the thrill of the game. And yeah, I want to end up like that. I don't know if it'll be for circus or for, I don't know what industry exactly, but I just want to end up, yeah, highly accomplished like that.
No, I hear you, and it's great to have that goal. Yeah.
Nice one, man. That was a great
All right.
conversation.
Thank you, and I appreciate you having me on. I'm very grateful to be invited on.
Oh, you're welcome. So I'll get this online now, and then we'll speak soon, and we'll do some more work together.
For sure. And Ben, do send me a message if I do forget to send you the booking link. So I'm going to jump on two more calls after this. So if I don't send it to you tonight, just be like, Adil, booking link.
Yeah.
Because I would love to have you on my show.
Sure, for
Yeah.
sure. I'll do it. Yeah.
All right, man. Have a great day.
Okay, you too. Bye.
Bye.